but gives an example, a couple examples of, even if he makes it more strict, it's still called harosh. But this, I emphasize to you again, it's so big deal that it makes it difficult. Most time we learn the Mishnah, made imsak. This was the mother of one of the kings of Israel, one of the later kings of Israel. Don't know the queen of Elamako. She was the mother of, she was from Beis Chashmonai, and she was the mother of Munboz, the king, who was one of the later kings of Israel. And her son was involved in a war, and she made a neder that she would become a nozer for 7 years if her son managed to survive the war and win the battle. And if she made the thing, and she became a nazira for 7 years. It was a chutz la'aretz that she did it. So there was a question whether or not she still had to do 7 years in Eretz Yisrael. So we learn in the Mishnah, Horah Machera, she still had to go 7 years on be a nazira in Eretz Yisrael as well. So we see from that, we call it Horah, even though it was more a strict application of it. No, whether this was a situation where the word was already Makuim, like, it was already, I think it was a question of living up to her response. Enam, that's another question, but this is what occurred at that time. Enam, here we give another example of Horah, Le'iser, Robo, Divi Rabbi. We're discussing the Chuta Shedra, the spinal column. There are some, you must know, there are certain sicknesses of an animal that can make it prohibited to be eaten, even though you can make a kosher shechita on it. We call those trephus. It would have died anyway. If it dies naturally, or if it's not slaughtered in a kosher shechita, yeah, that's in the veil. And if it's still alive, but it can't, it's got a so there's a dispute how much of the spinal column has to be gone in order for to make a trephus. So we learned that the time of Thomas, Adibir Rabbi says that you have to go and it's got to be a majority of the spinal column has to be broken in order to have this kind of trephus. And Rabbi Yaakov, even if you make a hole in the spinal column, it's sufficient. So Rabbi Yaakov is more strict in applying to make the question of an Easter of trephus than the Tanakhama or Rebbe. So Hora Rebbe to Rabbi Yaakov. Rebbe is like Rabbi Yaakov. Hora, again, the word Hora, he was more strict like Rabbi Yaakov. Huna Rabbi Huna says, Ein halacha k'Rabbi Yaakov, the halacha is really not like Rabbi Yaakov. All right, that's another thing. But the word horo is applied to a more strict. Okay, learn this way. Amar Rabbi Rabbi said, Shoal Yaakov asked the question, the Tzor, from Tzor, Es Rabbi Yochanan Betidon. He asked Rabbi Yochanan in the place called Tidon. Ano Shemia, and I heard it. What is the law? May a young husband consummate his marriage with a virgin bride on beginning and Shabbos? And he answered him, Osir. And the Gemara comes to the conclusion, the law is, it's permissible to have the first intercourse on Shabbos. So that ends the sugya here from this particular thing. After this, we will learn, believe that, about Erison, it's permissible because there are a lot of reasons. It's perhaps a kilko, or he doesn't have an intention.
6-3 to vote. 57-44.
Vote to you. I don't know if it says for anybody. But at least we learn about the concept of Horah.
He says, I think it takes just as much knowledge, Torah knowledge, to make it usher as it does to make it mutter. Just get this, if you're ushering something on a Jew, then that's a very serious thing too, and you have to have the backup to usher it.
All right, we'll go on to it further next.
Devor is in 4 verse 4.
No.
What's the thing?
I said it had the smell of wine when I kept it.
I tasted it, didn't have
but
the... It tastes like wine to me.
If one says it had the taste or the smell, there's a shiloh involved. If there's a smell that which is not water, does it make the broth questionable? Or what? Or let's say it was a 659 parts water.
You got to put it in water.
There's all kinds of. I'm a very cautious type.
I know that.
I didn't get through it.
But what is it that you're cautious about?
I'm cautious. Even when I intend to avoid an Easter, I might still leave a cosmic show fly. So I try to stay as far away from anything that could possibly.
There's some question in it. The question was, it had a smell of wine.
What is the whole thing's water? Because it was in a bottle.
I smelled wine. The wine in the water.
I drank it all. There's no wine in there. It's all water. Fox, clean the beans. Just puts the wine. Why the color?
I smelled
the
wine.
I have it there. I don't get involved in anything
that's questionable
in the least degree. I have learned this from what I was forced by circumstances to make a promise when I was getting Kabbalah and Shechita, Hadoah. My Rebbe that taught me extracted a promise from me, which I thought was, well, at the time I thought it was very difficult, but I accepted it. He said, at those times there was a challenge about the ice cream cones, and so he says, I want you to promise, I will not give you this hodah until you promise to me that you will never eat another ice cream cone the rest of your life.
The thing is, because
he did it.
I know he did it, but is he
and I said I would not, and I got the hodah, and that was 37 years ago, and I haven't eaten an ice cream cone up to this time. But I understood from what he asked of me that, in fact, what he asked of me
was the cone he's talking about, or it could be the ice cream.
He told me specifically cone. Now, and then I learned from this, I learned that maybe in government takeover, that when a person becomes a sheikh, he must be zor to the very nth degree about what comes into his mouth as food.
Okay.
I cannot hear such a shout.
Was it to drink water?
To drink it.
No.
What is wrong? What can I? Is there anything wrong here?
No.
You have to be as careful at this stage as he has.
Well, I don't like that kind of answer. I never like that kind of answer because
he doesn't understand.
No, I don't.
What?
Is it because
you understand?
Is it the difference because you're shelfed?
Still kosher all these years.
I want that. Just drink all that water.
Deborah was a woman prophetess, the wife of Lapidus. She judged Israel at that time. This is Shoftim Dalet, Pasuk Dalet, Judges chapter 4, verse 4. You see, my Rebbe is a great Rav. Listen to his tapes with joy and heed his words of rebuke with love.
Tonight we will discuss the Parshas Ekev and Devorim. And we discussed it before we davened Mincha, and now we're at after Ma'ariv. And as we learned in the Gemara Tainis, from the 15th day of Av and further on, since the nights are now getting bigger and the days getting shorter, it's considered a mitzvah, a special mitzvah, not only to learn Torah in the daytime, but also in the nighttime. And that's what we're trying to do. As a matter of fact, the Gemara there in Tainis, and the end of Tainis, and Daf Lamed Aleph, right at the end of the Gemara Tainis, tells us that if, God forbid, a person doesn't add to his Torah learning, he could, God forbid, suffer a debt penalty. Of course, that we don't have to take that literally, but it is an admonition that a person has to serve God in every way possible. And it fits in with this week's Sedra, Ekev, as we learned just before Mincha. We were discussing the first word of the Pasuk. It says, because you will listen to these ordinances and watch them and do them, that God in turn will watch his command, his covenant with you, and the kindness that he swore to your forefathers, and he will love you and he will bless you and he will increase everything that you have. So the word Ekev, Rashi says at the beginning of Rashi there, I'll repeat it again for those of you that weren't here the first session. Ima mitzvahs akalos. If the mitzvahs that are considered by many people very unimportant, easy mitzvahs, and they sha'odam doshbe akavav tishmoon, that a person stands on them akav. Akav is also the sole of the foot. Some people, unfortunately, have a conception that they can approach the Torah observance of God with a smorgasbord approach, which I mentioned to you before. You take what you want and you leave what you don't want. That's not the Jewish religion. The Jewish religion requires us to observe all the commandments of God, regardless whether we in our understanding think that they're important or not important. So people have a tendency of rationalizing their position, and they say to themselves, there are a lot of important commandments which I am prepared to try to do, but the unimportant ones I'm not going to do. Now, who made them such a tremendous Talmud scholar that they can Iber Paskin the Rabbeinu Shalom, that they now greater in Torah than God forbid? It's impossible to conceive that a human being can possibly know as much as God. And God in His wisdom tells us there are certain things that you have to do, regardless if our human intelligence doesn't understand it, we still have the obligation to do it. So if a person will not only take care of what he thinks is important, but he will try to do to the utmost of his ability all the commandments of God and not make any differentiation between good, big ones or small ones or easy ones or hard ones, then in turn God will go and fulfill His promises and He will bless you.
So what does that phrase mean, Shalom Das Beikir?
That a person, he ordinarily steps on it like it's something not important. You understand? If you will listen to these ones that you would people would ordinarily ignore, then you will be blessing to get these blessings. In other words, in order to trigger the blessings that God has in store for every righteous type, you must in fact become a righteous type. This is what's required. Once you are eligible and you remain a righteous type, you do in fact get blessings from God, and God blesses you all the way through. And this is what so many of us don't understand. Moshe Rabbeinu here is now in these last sedras. He's now going to go and turn over the reins of government to Jewish people, to Yoshua ben Nun. He's no longer going to be among them. And so he's admonishing them what in fact they have to do. Up to now he was able to plead for them and to go and ask God to take care of the Jewish people. If the Jews made a mistake, he would be there to intercede. But no, he won't be here anymore to do it. So it's their responsibility now from this point on to be mature enough to face their own responsibility. When a child is of tender years, we expect the child to make mistakes. And therefore the parents are there to admonish the child, don't do what you're doing because you might hurt yourself. Or don't do this, avoid doing this. And the child rebels against it, but expects that if there's really a crisis, something bad happens because you did something wrong, then the parents will take care of it. There's a time when, God forbid, after 120 years, the parents are no longer there. The child has to grow up. He has to be mature. The children of Israel have now been taught by Moshe Rabbeinu for 40 years how to live. And they've always depended on Moshe Rabbeinu to get them out of their troubles that they self-made. So he says, now there's a time now that you have to strengthen your own requirements, your own religiosity, and stand on your own 2 feet and expect that if you really want these blessings that you're talking about, you have to do what you're required to do. You cannot expect that you can go and not do your best and expect the blessings that God is prepared to give to you. Because Davening Mincha, Michoel asked a shayla. Michoel, do you remember what you asked?
When I was reading it, that God was angry with Israel, and that it seemed like He was ready to destroy all of Israel, but yet convinced them not to.
All right, now we have to understand it. The Medrash of this week's Sedra on Ekov, Grada talks about that very concept. This actually, God is telling Moshe Rabbeinu what the situation is. And this is actually, it's in Medrash Rabbah, Ekev, Parsha Gimel, and the Sif is Tesvov, the 15th paragraph. In the middle of the 15th paragraph, it says like this. I will translate. You don't have copies of it, but I'll translate it loosely and give you a concept. See, Moshe Rabbeinu understood that the Bnei Yisrael, the children of Israel, are beloved in God's eyes. God loves them. And when God, obviously, if God is prepared to take the Jewish people out of the house of bondage and to go and take them out over the consent of the Egyptians and to force the issue by all these miracles, there's no way in the world that you don't realize that God loves this people. This is a blessed nation from God. What the reasons are many. Suffice it to say that God loves the Jewish people very much indeed. And so this is not some kind of a secret that God loves the Jewish people. Now God says to Moshe, you have to perform a function here. When I selected you to lead Jewish people out of Egypt, you must perform a function. Now, especially in this time of crisis, when they have, like for instance, at the time when they built the Eglazol, the golden calf, this is a time of crisis. There is a time that there has to be a judgment of God taking effect, and God forbid, if it's not controlled, God forbid, the whole nation, God forbid, could be destroyed. So God says to Moshe, we cannot both be angry. Medrash Rabbah says, we cannot both be angry at the same time. You're representing the Jewish people, and I'm their God. And so if I get angry, and at the same time you get angry, between the two of our angers, we can, God forbid, destroy the Jewish people.
What happened to
God? Was pointing out to Moshe, God pointing out to Moshe that you have to go down from heaven, and because they have built a.
Wasn't Moshe angry?
He later on.
Oh.
God said to him, "This is the way it's set up. I told you this before, but here's the Midrash and tells you this. God says like this: if I approach a crisis, a pool. In other words, level in my way I talk about it, you can evidence a sense of irritation. If I evidence irritation, you should evidence coolness. Because if we both go on the same side at the same time, we both are angry at the same time, between the two of us, each outdo each other, and God forbid, the Jewish people won't be protected.
Let me ask you, can I ask you a basic question?
Yes, sir.
How can you attribute human attributes to God? Like Adam, I'm just saying, the concept of God is...
Let's put it like this.
You know what I mean? How can you say God was angry?
The words of the Torah are written in the language of human beings. We are talking in language that we human beings can comprehend. Obviously, if you're going to give us a Torah that is beyond our comprehension, we can't possibly be expected to observe the commandments.
Yeah,
because you're going to tell us you got to do some lofty metaphysical thing.
You can say God was angry.
It says this. I would describe it as an impatience or irritation. Yes.
It's not to be taken literally, I think, because there's a phrase, and God came down from heaven on a cloud. It doesn't mean you see the sky riding a cloud.
It's not to be interpreted. But we are interpreting it in this fashion, that the both cannot be, the Midrash says, in anger at the same time. He says, when you see me heated up, you should be more cool. And when I see that you are cool, then I can give vent to a certain amount of heating up. You understand? It's a question of maintaining a balance. This is what God wants the relationship between him and Moshe should be. So God says to Moshe, at this point, I am now being heated up. Because they're doing something that this is the God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. They're talking about a golden calf. So Moshe Rabbeinu says, what should I do? He says, you should seek my mercy. So Moshe goes ahead and says, starts praying to God. He says, God, why should you be angry against your people? You brought out of Egypt with a great strength and everything. And the Egyptians will come and say that you took them out to do evil to them, to destroy them in the wilderness. And so therefore return from the heat of your anger, and do not do the evil that you were intending to do to your people. What?
He's perfect. He wouldn't...
No question about it. No, we're describing it as anger. Let's put it like this. It is a analysis of the situation to determine what the proper course to follow has to be done in relation to the attributes of justice and also the attributes of mercy. that this world was created by God with both attributes. And it must be this blending of both attributes that is necessary. It is necessary that God deal justly with his creatures, because otherwise it will be a defeat of definition that God is just. On the other hand, it is also necessary God to temper his justice with mercy. This is the function of a great tzaddik like Moshe Rabbeinu, who should pray to God at times of crisis to the Jewish people, and he's example for others of also tzaddikim, that from time to time when the Jewish people are in crisis, they in turn pray to God. They are to act as partners in coming to this final decision as to what in fact is going to be done to the Jewish people. This is the purpose of a tzaddik. Tzaddik is to work together with God to come out to a proper disposition of what in fact should be done in this situation. It does not mean to imply that God is a human being. It just means to imply that God is fair and God is merciful in what he does. He is just, and if he is approached in a proper way by a proper person, he is also merciful. You understand this concept? In other words, it's not meaning to imply that God is like a human being that loses control. God doesn't lose control. But God demands a measured approach to justice, because God will not tolerate a type of a justice that's unfair. And a lot of times, a justice has to be done deliberately, not swiftly. As we have in the beginning of Pirkei Avos, when Jewish judges admonish, he should be deliberate in judgment. He should not be swift to make a decision, because you have to analyze the entire situation in order to make sure that the justice that's being rendered is a true justice. And this is in fact what's happening here. God, of course, understands that the Jewish people have grievously sinned, but the Medrash tells us that God knew this in the beginning. He, at the time he first approached Moshe Rabbeinu at the burning bush, he knew in the beginning that they would sin. God doesn't know that's going to happen. And even though he knew in the beginning, he redeemed them from Egypt. He knew from the beginning that they would in fact make a mistake. And they would worship David. So the question is to ask, very simple. The same question was asked by Gideon, asked the question in the time there when the Jewish people had already come into Eretz Israel and lived for many years in the time of the Shoftim, yeah, in the book of Judges. He asked God the same question. If the Jewish people were not worthy of redeeming them, you still found a reason to redeem them. So if they were worthy, redeem us before their sake. And if they weren't worthy, then redeem us just like you redeemed them at those times. In other words, God does not necessarily destroy something. For instance, the Baruch Hashem, the Jewish people have tzaddikim in every generation. So for no other reason, it's not mentioned here, but for no other reason, because they will have tzaddikim later on, they should not be destroyed. If God can let a pagan nations that worship idols to exist, because they're going to have righteous types coming out of them, so much more so we'll let the Jewish people to exist, because they have many more righteous types that come out of them, because they are observing the mitzvahs of the Torah. This makes for righteous types. You understand? Any questions, Sam? No, I'm not trying to browbeat you into something. He says like this. He says, this is what the Medrash says. Medrash says, God, Moshe says before God, Rabbeinu Shem, Master of the World, I know that you love your people, your children, and you don't really wish to seek to destroy them. And you really wish me to speak well of them. So God, Moshe understood what his role was. And in fact, he did a very good job in relation to what his role was. He spoke as a defense attorney for the Jewish people. Yes.
If we don't use human terms, how can we understand a being that never began and always will be?
That's true. We cannot understand the intrinsic nature of God. Rambam says that. It's impossible. It's beyond our comprehension, as the Medrash explains it. We're not insisting that it's supposed to be interpreted as a literal explanation. This is an allegorical explanation of what in fact is occurring. And we've gone over this before in other shiurim. Most points out to God that in fact there was really no necessity to destroy the Jewish people for what they did. Because he approached them, and this is a different medrash, not here. A medrash, somebody's house, Moshe says, that's wonderful, they got another God. So he can help you in the work of running the world. He can have the wind flow or the rains go, and he can help you. So he says, Moshe, it seems that you're also making a mistake. He says, if he's not a God, then why are you getting so excited about it? There's no really any competition involved. As Rashi says that actually in Kisiso. He says the thing, who is angry about something if you got competition? In truth, there's no competition. They can't make a God. You're the only God that really exists. Everything else is figments of imagination. They don't exist at all. Again, anytime a person goes away from Torah mitzvahs, he in fact is a type of Aveda Zora. It's a type of Aveda Zora. We have in our time and age, we have people that claim they're observing Yiddishkeit, but they're not. They call it Judaism, but they don't observe the Jewish faith because they are making their own rules up. Go along and ignore the rules of the Torah, which is improper and certainly not to be tolerated or to given tolerance called legitimate. It's not legitimate at all. You have these reform and conservative reconstructionist types going around, and they make their own rules. It goes along. They don't observe the halakha, and they brazen their way through every situation. I'm not saying they don't do sometimes a good thing, but they are in the main not God-fearing. And many of them, unfortunately, not only are not God-fearing, they're not even knowledgeable. They can't even learn a blot Gemara. I mean, how can they go and be a posek on a question of halacha when they can't even learn in Vedic, in the Shulchan Aruch or in the Gemara? They can't even learn inside. The only ones that could are the ones that went to the Orthodox Yeshivas, and even those, unfortunately, are not God-fearing, so they don't observe the law in the first place, even if they knew it, which is a very terrible thing. And this is one of the terrible things we have in our generation, and that we have to fight. But we can't fight it by turning our backs on what we have to do. We have to, in turn, we have to intensify our Torah learning, our Yerushim. We have to become knowledgeable in the Torah so that we can counteract this negativism that's approaching, coming out of it. All right. So Moshe Rabbeinu appeals to God, and finally he says, even if there's no other reason, treat him like you treated Sodom and Amorah. Remember the wicked cities? Was told by God he's going to destroy these cities. They're very wicked. So Avraham Avinu says, you find 50 righteous types, let them live for their 50 righteous types. And then he says, well, can't find 50, find 45. And then the Rashi tells you, got them down to really 9. And with God would be 10. So the Medrash here, the Perish Marzol, has a difficulty because he got them down to 77 tzaddikim. There were the 70 elders, and then in addition to the 70 elders, there was... No, he didn't mention Yeshua and Moshe, so therefore Caleb. He asked the question there. Caleb was one of Pinchas, and Isomar, Eliezer, presumably before Noban Abido died, and called 77. Then finally, Yeshua Rabbeinu brings out the fact that there are the three obos. They were all tzaddikim, Yitzchon Yaakov. And he says, if you won't count them, you swore by them that you would, how will you face them when you make them alive again? You promised you would. So you face them. He gives them a lot of reasons why. So finally God says, okay, I accept it, and I won't destroy them for the sake of these rights. The important thing is to understand, out of all these people here, you had over 600,000 men, all they could find, even if you take the larger number, was 77. If he doesn't count himself and his student, Yeshua. So that was a very small number. So it's another thing that to let us understand that becoming a righteous type in the degree that is necessary in order to be a shield and a protection for Jewish people requires a tremendous dedication to service of God. It's possible for every Jew to become such a righteous type. There's nobody boxed out from that. But it requires a lifetime of dedication to the proper actions. And this is what's required. This the whole Seder is talking about Moshe Rabbeinu telling them, I'm not going to be here anymore.
It's a time for you now to straighten out your position and understand that I'm not going to be here to plead for you. You have to make yourself now mature enough about your religion that you have to be a righteous type in your own marriage. And you have to become tzaddikim. If you do, God will bless you. And this is what, this is the whole message of the whole thing. There's one note that Medrash talks about Moshe Rabbeinu saw that he was pleading for the Jewish people every time they had something that they needed. But unfortunately, now his brother and his sister are already dead. He was the only one left of that generation. Unfortunately, nobody was pleading for him. So he saw... Nobody was pleading for him, praying to God that he should have the spruce to go over the yard, except himself. So when he saw that nobody was pleading for him, so he just put it aside. And he said to the, he just said, now I have to tell you what you've got to do. Because if they're not going to plead for him, at least he's going to show them the way that they're supposed to go. This is what God demands of you.
Why did they pray for him?
You have to be great enough in vision to understand that even the greatest person requires also help. He's a person. He's a human being.
I know, but Yahshua was one of the greatest prophets.
Perhaps he didn't want to speak in the presence of his teacher.
And so we wait until he was God.
That's a shadow.
Did they change?
As a matter of fact, there was an incident taught about in this Medrash. I want to leave you with this. There's one little incident talked about in this Medrash. There was a incident of Rabbi Yochanan that he was traveling with a kusi, one of the goyim that were imported into Eretz Israel after the 10 tribes were exiled. So he was traveling with a kusi, and he was traveling with a Jewish helper that was leading his donkey. He was riding on the donkey, and the kusi was traveling there, and they came to Har Gerizim, was the mountain that the Jewish people, you asked that question about the next week's Seder of the Eid, the blessing and the curse, and these two mountains the Jewish people gathered there. The Har Gerizim was the mountain that was very holy to the Kusi. That's where they used to worship their idol. So when he passed the mountain, he says, this mountain is very holy. He says, Rabbi, tell me why the mountain is very holy. The Rabbi says, why is it holy? He says he figured out that it must have been, there was no flood. Flood did not cover that mountain when God brought the flood in time of Noah. So the rabbi asked him, he says, if God didn't bring the flood, then why was it necessary for, the question was asked, why was it necessary for Noah to build the ark? And that was told, and Noah had to build the ark so that the people should ask questions, perhaps they do tshuva. Understand? And so he says, I have a posik from Yechezkel. I can't seem to follow it here. I just thought I was learning earlier as to the fact that it was not flooded. Actually, this medrash, I have seen another medrash which says, in fact, a Gemara, which says, in fact, there is an opinion that Eretz Israel was not, in fact, flooded by the flood, although the rest of the world was. But take that aside. We're going according to the authority that holds that the whole world was flooded. So the rabbi couldn't answer that pasuk that said that God did not in his anger pour a rain upon the Holy Land. The mule leader, the Jewish man, the mule leader, was not very learned. But he says, Rabbi, if you'll give me permission, I'll answer him. They gave him permission. He said, it says in the Torah that the flood covered, he says, do you admit that this mountain is under the heavens or is it in the heavens? He says, no, it's under the heavens. He says, and it says in the Torah that the flood covered 15 cubits over the highest mountains over the entire earth. So therefore it had to have covered. You get it? So we see from there that when the knowledge of Torah is spread over the entire Jewish people, what one person may not answer, even if he's a great person, one that may be lesser in knowledge could answer. And together, there could come a proper answer. And that's what's our requirement. We all have to learn Torah. We all have to become as great as we can, and then we can interplay with our knowledge, and with God's help, be able to present a proper front. Yes.
So why was the mountain holy?
No, the mountain is no more holy than any other mountain. And the whole land of Eretz Israel is holy. But
what was the answer?
The answer was that in fact it wasn't any more holy than the other place. That's what the rabbi said. Okay, but I'll leave you at this point, and Belina Eder will have the next year Sunday. Okay, last week, Sedra, Ikev, and Devorim, I want to call your attention to Pusik Aperik Tes, that's chapter 8, Gimel, the third verse. Would you read that, Menachem? Gimel, Ches Gimel. Wait, but you're on side. Turn the page. Wheel. Ches Gimel. Here, right there.
Come on.
Read that passage. You have it now? Nothing to it once you get the knack of it.
Right. Yeah. Still a question. Ashla Yitad, see the Shem Yehudam.
All right, Jeff, what does that translate?
Lewis not, but by even word.
All right, instead of this, he humbled you.
Should I
read this? All right, read the translation.
And he afflicted thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knowest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know, but by everything that proceeded.
We have a thing here. God fed the Jewish people wandering in the desert for 40 years from a mysterious type of food that was never known before this time. This type of food was some kind like, it looked like seeds, that God put a layer of dew on the ground, and then he put these seeds there overnight, and then in the morning he had covered with another layer of dew, and then when the sun shone, they came and they gathered these seeds. These seeds were miraculous food, bread from heaven. We call it manna. And this bread from heaven was a very miraculous food. The food was such that no matter what you wanted to eat, that's the way it tasted. That's a miraculous food. You like steak? You eat it. Tastes like steak. You don't like steak, you want something else. Whatever you want, to take, it tastes like that, with a few exceptions. It's everything that you would like. And you didn't have to go to the washroom after you ate it either. But you had strength and you were able to live. This is a wonderful food from God. And now it says, he afflicted you. He afflicted. What is the affliction? After all, God's giving you food from heaven. What kind of affliction is that? You can talk about affliction when you got something, God forbid. You're hungry, you don't have food or anything like that, or you're lacking in some other thing. That's affliction. But what does the word affliction mean when it's referring to something that God's giving you? And he gave it on a daily basis, except for Shabbos. They couldn't find any of this manna from heaven. What did God do? Erev Shabbos, on Friday, he made a double portion so that when people gathered, they had twice as much, so they had enough for that day, Erev Shabbos, and also for Shabbos. And this is one of the signs that they knew that God held the Shabbos as a holy day. Yes?
Did they get more food for Shabbos than they did for the rest of the week?
Not necessarily. What happened was miraculously, when they gathered the food, no matter how much they gathered, it turned out that they had enough for 2 days.
But what about Shabbos? You're supposed to have Shabbos Shudas on Shabbos.
Well, so they had enough for everything. No problem. No problem at all. Now, what is this? Aniyah, you know, we have another halacha. And Kumish talks about that you have a responsibility on Yom Kippur to afflict your soul. On Yom Kippur, we don't eat, drink, live with our spouses sexually. We don't wear leather shoes, and we don't anoint ourselves with oil. Certain affliction makes a person more uncomfortable.
And now, what? Washing.
Not washing yourself. Now, affliction is in order that we should become humble, and thereby be able to pray to God in the proper way, to ask him to forgive us, and we have an atonement for whatever we have sinned during throughout the year. Now, and that's particularly a special occasion, because on that day, Moshe Rabbeinu came down from heaven with the second tablets, and it was like a real new giving of the Torah. And it's a special celebration on that particular day. So God dedicated that day for the Jews to get forgiveness. Now, here we have again that a person is afflicted. Now, what's the affliction? We have to understand. The affliction is this. You must understand, not all the time, even though you are blessed by God, does everybody get everything they want sufficiently ahead of time that they don't have to go and worry about when the next day will bring. Because in fact what happened, each day they had to have faith in God that somehow God would provide the food they needed the next day. Because they were to eat what God gave them that day, and then they had to have faith. And they had to suffer this affliction. Yes, similar.
How about all the time? All they know is get up.
Well, first, I'm.
You know,
no, but I'm talking about this particular concept.
Yeah.
You have here an affliction, even though it is a bracha. You have to have faith in God every day that that manna will fall from heaven.
Isn't
I'm talking on Sam. We're on Pesuk Gimel of Perek Anu, Anakom. The Anakom, God afflicted us by giving us this manna from heaven. So we have this concept. Now the affliction there. Now, I'll ask a very difficult question, perhaps the answer. Why, in fact, did God afflict us? Why didn't he give us enough of manna that we can eat for several days? Why did we have to go every single day to go and ask God to do this thing? All right, Chaim Moshe.
So we have the faith in God that God will give us the food every day.
That's good. Similar. Naturally, it's your husband's answer, so it's obvious.
Maybe they don't. I just start feeling everything's on the point where they don't, you know, require.
That's right. Okay, now, right.
The mother in itself was like, no food can have every flavor in it except for this thing. So it was like a treasure. And if people could hoard it.
No, but we don't want affliction at all. Why affliction at all? We know that the Rabbeinu Shetov HaRashem HaTov, God is good to everybody. We say in Ashrei, in the 145th Psalm, that God is good to every person. His good is without measure. Now, why in affliction? Yes.
Okay, I was thinking, the Sedrach says, Laman Anoscha,
yes,
in order to afflict you and to test you.
Right.
This affliction was really just a test.
Are you serious?
Sir, to see what.
You remember we learned the Gemara in Brachas. And this, in fact, what was necessary, in order that the Jewish people would be able to come to a true appreciation of Torah, how much they are, in fact, dependent upon the Borei Olam, the Rabbeinu Shlom, for everything, and to come to the anivus, to the humbleness, which will lead them to Yiras Shamayim. Reishis Chokhma Yiras Hashem. Reishis Chokhma Yiras Hashem. Yiras Hashem leads to Chokhma Satorah. And this is what's necessary. This was a necessary prerequisite so that they should be, in turn, be able to learn Torah. Hold this point and we'll learn after.
No, not now.
And now we'll continue where we start, where we were learning. There is a Shaila I will discuss later on that I asked in relation to a Midrash. And I had yesterday in Shabbos, and my other share is Dash Shura. But before that, I'd like to continue with our concept. In the Parshas Ekev in the Devarim, it starts out that because if you will listen to do my commandments, God will bless you with various things. And Rashi points out that if a person will be particular, even in the areas where most people are very not particular, a lot of people have a tendency of assuming that there are mitzvahs that they should observe and mitzvahs that they can, with impunity, without any penalty, ignore. Like they stamp on it with their feet, with the soles of their feet. Akiva could also be translated as also being the soul of the foot, you know, like a person stamps on it but he doesn't care about it. Unfortunately, people have a tendency to rationalize and assume that they know so much about God's will that they can dissect it and say, this is what's important to God and the rest we can ignore because presumably since we think it's not important, so therefore to God it's not important, which of course is a ridiculous way of approaching it. If God did not think it was important, he wouldn't have told you to do it in the first place. So obviously there's a fallacy in the argument and in the reason. Moshe Rabbeinu is telling the Jewish people, as I mentioned earlier, that he's no longer to be among them, and from now on they have to go and make sure that they do not make the mistakes that we were making during the time he was alive. He won't be there anymore to correct them by prayer or otherwise, to seek that God's forgiveness. So now he's telling them, you have to be a complete Jew in every sense of the word. You have to observe all the mitzvahs the best of your capacity. Yes, Chaim Moshe. Okay.
In reality, did the level of what they were accountable for go down when he died, in order that they should be judged with more rachmanis after Moshe Rabbeinu's death?
What do you mean by
that? Well, if like a little, not too much after Moshe Rabbeinu's death, they went and they did a lot of things that they shouldn't have done.
After Yeshua died.
That wasn't too much after Moshe Rabbeinu died.
No, 14 years later. Yes,
so,
let him finish his.
So thing. All I'm saying is that because then they were doing very bad things. Now they didn't have a Moshe Rabbeinu to pray for them.
No,
they didn't have anybody who could go out who could. Like more,
Yeshua and could talk to God. They were both Nevi.
Not the same way.
Not obviously.
So that's why I'm saying that the level that was expected of them declined, or were they judged with more rachmanis after Moshe Rabbeinu wasn't there to talk for them anymore and wasn't
there
to argue.
There's no question about it that the Rabbeinishim being a Baal Rach will adjust any situation to whatever is required.
Because with the Abel Azov, he was ready to destroy the Jewish people.
Not
and then
really. Not to be interpreted that way. The Medrash tells us, the Medrash Rabbah, that Moshe Rabbeinu understood, and God, he understood this quite well, that God loved the Jewish people, and he did not want to destroy them. And the function that God pointed out, and he says, your function is to be like a counterbalance to me. A kaviyoko, a human being, can be a counterbalance to the warrior. In this sense, that if I get excited about something they did and made a mistake, you should be more calm about it. On the other hand, if you get excited about a mistake they make, I in turn will be more calm about it. And between the two of us, we'll protect the basic interests of the Jewish
people. You're speaking in human terminology, but what
yes.
does it mean by God getting excited with something that they did?
The Rabbinism has to go and act in a just fashion.
Right.
There's no question about it. But in this world, if all we have is strict justice and no mercies, we can't exist. Unfortunately, we have, or perhaps fortunately, we have a Yetzer Hara, and we are prone to making mistakes. There's no way in which we can
avoid it. So Moshe Rabbeinu was there to be a catalyst that would change God's mita of din.
Similarly, I have a Shiloh. What's the Yetzer Hara? Yes. That's set up. Yeah.
That's because he cannot ignore din.
He wanted Moshe not just to be a yes person and say, whatever you want to do, God, do it. He didn't want that. He wanted to protect the interests of the Jewish people to the utmost. And therefore, he wanted, yes.
So,
God at that point gave Moshe Rabbeinu a hint. Leave me alone, like Rabbeinu. He's giving him a hint that this is your time to speak for Melech Yosher for the Bnei Yisrael. That's exactly what he did. In other words, he did his shlichus faithfully. There's no question about it. Moshe Rabbeinu was a faithful shliach. That was the reason, one of the reasons that God selected him in the first place. He knew he would be a proper pleader for the Jewish people, and he wanted it that way. He wanted the Jewish people to be protected. Now, obviously, if God forbid, there is not a Moshe Rabbeinu alive to protect the Jewish people, God will compensate for that. To answer your question, there's no question about it. There might be the other tzaddikim that might live in that generation, or whatever is necessary to compensate God, because the basic thrust is that he wants the Jewish people to continue to exist. Now,
but I'm saying because Moshe Rabbeinu then, what do we have now?
All right, now Moshe Rabbeinu now, to progress further now. Moshe Rabbeinu now having told the Jewish people that he is going away, and he is now admonishing them that they should strengthen themselves and they become more mature in their responsibilities and accept, in fact, the obligation to become a complete Jew, a shlemistik yid, a complete a Jew in every sense of the word, that they have to go and live up to all their responsibilities. So now he's going to go in and